Welcome and Yali Badad. My name is Zahir Qasim and I'm the chairman of the Aga Khan Economic Planning Board for Canada. We are going through challenging economic times with inflation at a 30-year high, rising interest rates, and a bleak global growth outlook. Couple that with geopolitical upheavals and supply chain issues, we live in a world of much uncertainty. How will this impact the Canadian economy over the next while? And what are the steps that each one of us can take to protect ourselves and find opportunity in this environment? These are some of the questions we will go through in today's economic webinar. Joining us today is Pierre Cléroux. Pierre is the chief economist at the Business Development Bank of Canada, also called BDC. He leads a team of experts who analyze economic data to identify business and sector trends impacting Canadian entrepreneurs. Pierre has also served as the Assistant Deputy Minister for Economic Development and Innovation and Export Trade for Quebec, responsible for the implementation of economic policies and programs to support small and medium-sized businesses and encourage entrepreneurship. It is a pleasure to have Pierre join us today to share his thoughts with the Jamaat. Our moderator is Shirin Kabani. Shirin is the Managing Director and Chief Financial Officer for Ninepoint Financial, which has over $8 billion in assets and institutional contracts with over 75 employees across Canada. Ninepoint Financial is among the largest independent asset management firms in Canada. Shirin is responsible for providing an effective financial governance framework for the company and leading ongoing finance operations. I give you Pierre and Shirin in conversation. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman Zahir, for your warm introduction and setting the context for our discussion. My name is Shirin Kabani, and I will be moderating today's webinar on Canada's economic update. Before we start, we just want to provide a disclaimer that all discussions during the course of this webinar are the views and opinions of the speakers themselves and do not necessarily reflect the views of their employers or affiliates. The information provided does not constitute financial, legal, tax, or investment advice or recommendations. Let me give you a little bit more about our session. So we have structured our session today into two parts. First, Pierre Cléroux will provide an overview and an outlook of the current economic landscape in Canada. This will be followed by a question and answer session where Pierre will delve deep into key focus areas to give our viewers at home some insight into how best to navigate through this dynamic environment and challenging times. I now have the absolute honor and privilege of introducing our distinguished guest for today, Pierre Cléroux, Vice President, Research and Chief Economist at the Business Development Bank of Canada. Thank you, Pierre, for making time in your busy schedule to speak to us today. I will now hand it over to you.
Thank you, Shirin. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to share my screen. Just give me 1 second here. Everybody should see my screen by now. My presentation today is about what should we expect about the economy for the next 12 to 24 months. So I will start with talking about the economy, where we are, talking about two risks that we see for the economy. As you know, there's a lot of turbulence right now. So I'm going to talk about, are we going to have a recession or not? I'm going to try to answer this question. And finally, the last part is about what to watch for business people in 2022. So first, let's start with the world economy. Our forecast is the world economy is going to grow by 3.6% this year and also in 2023, which is quite a solid growth for the world. So despite all the turbulence that we see in the world economy is still growing. However, there's two regions who are slowing down this year. One is China, The Chinese economy is having a lot of difficulties with COVID-19. There's a very large number of cases right now, and it's slowing down the growth in China. China is not in recession, will still have positive growth, but growth of more around 4%. We used to see China at a much higher level than that. The second region that is affected is Europe. The European countries, because of the war in Ukraine, is having a slowdown in the economy. Again, we're not expecting a recession, but we're expecting a slowdown in Europe. But overall, the world economy is still on a positive slope. But of course, the most important economy for us is the United States. Not only is it still the number one economy in the world, but that's our number one trade partner. 78% of everything we export is going to the U.S. So the news over there are quite good. The unemployment rate in the U.S. is 3.6%, almost as low as before the pandemic. And these two numbers, 3.5 and 3.6, are very low unemployment rate for the United States. Just last month, the U.S. economy created more than almost 400,000 jobs. So the economy is still performing quite well, and thanks to consumers. Consumers are mostly responsible for the growth. Over the last 2 years, Americans' wealth has been increasing thanks to government program that has been very generous in the U.S., but also to the good job market. So people have jobs, salaries are increasing, which make people having more money. And one thing they do with that money is they spend. Consumptions of goods in the U.S. has increased by more than 15%, which is very, very significant. Usually, consumptions increase by 1 or 2% every year. So 15%, this is very significant, and it was quite a shock on the economy. And that's the reason why we have inflation so high in the U.S. Just because there's so much money in the economy, consumers are spending money, and that put price up. And that's the reason why we believe that interest rate in the U.S. is going to keep increasing. Interest rate, the prime rate, has been increasing twice since the beginning of this year, and we expect more interest rate increase to try to release the pressure on inflation. So despite the fact that interest rates are increasing, our forecast for the U.S. is still quite positive, 3.2% for this year. It's lower than last year, but it's still very significant. So if we achieve 3% growth, it would be one of the best growth in the U.S. in the last decade. Canada now, this is where we are in terms of the recovery. The graph that you see is the number of jobs in Canada. So we started the pandemic with 19.1 million jobs. We lost 3 million jobs at the beginning of the pandemic. We have recuperated all these jobs, and today we are well over 19 million. So it is about 500,000 more jobs today in Canada than before the pandemic. So basically, the Canadian economy is back to normal, back to the pre-crisis level. But the recovery has been quite different from one sector to another. Some sectors have been performing very well. ICT, as you can see right at the top of the graph, is doing very well. The level of economic activities in ICT is 10% higher than before the pandemic. So that's quite significant. At the bottom of the graph, you can see some sectors that are having more difficulties: accommodation and food services, art and entertainment. As you know, most of the restriction on because of the COVID-19 was imposed on these sectors because of the nature of the relationships, you know, the client-facing aspect of these sectors. So that's the reason why these sectors have been affected more than other sectors. However, for example, in tourism is coming back. We are expecting a very strong summer in terms of tourism. So accommodation and food services should definitely come back to normal at the end of this year. So what is going to drive growth in 2022 and 2023? Well, in Canada, just like in the US, consumers are going to be the main driver of the economy. The unemployment rate in Canada is now 5.2%. This is lower than the 5.7 before the pandemic. And it's actually at 5.2. This is the lowest unemployment rate in the last 50 years. So the shortage of labor across the country, businesses have difficulties to find people. But the good news is for people, well, there's a lot of job out there. And not only people have job, but their disposable income has been increasing in Canada. Again, just like in the U.S., thanks to government program during the recession, but also thanks to a very strong job market. Salaries are increasing, And that means that people are having more money in their pocket. And on top of it, they have been saving quite a bit of money over the last 2 years, much more than before, which is not surprising. In every recession, consumers are saving money because of the uncertainty. But the last 2 years has been exceptional. The level of savings has been really increasing. This is important because it means that people are going to continue to spend money now that the pandemic is almost over. So consumption in Canada has increased by 5.3%, which is quite significant. You might wonder, this is much lower than in the US, but as you know, in Canada, we're always a bit more responsible. So we have less extreme fluctuation, and 5.3 is quite solid for Canada. And so this consumption is going to continue this year and in 2023. As people have a job, their income has been increasing, they have saved quite a bit of money. So part of this money is going to be spent. So the main driver of the economy is going to be coming from the consumer side. But there's another driver in Canada, which is commodity prices. The graph that you see is it's a combination of many commodity prices. As you can see, it has been increasing very significantly. Strong demand from the world, but also the war in Ukraine is increasing the price of commodity. And for Canada, this is a good news because, as you know, we produce a lot of commodities. So this is good for the Canadian economy. It's going to be a source of growth for this year. Another source of growth is our export. Our export is way above the level that we had before the pandemic, thanks to the U.S. economy that has been performing well. So the demand for Canadian products and commodities has been strong. And this is another source for the Canadian economy. Finally, the housing market has been a big source of growth over the last 2 years. It's slowing down now as interest rates are increasing. We can see that the volume of sales has been declining. So when interest rates are increasing, people are not buying as many houses and prices have been starting to decline. So this is quite normal when interest rates increase, we see less activities. We don't believe this is going to become like a big decline, but definitely the level of price is going to be a bit more stable than what we have seen over the last 2 years. So prices has increased significantly, as you can see from this graph, over the last 2 years, because interest rates were very low. Now we're going more to a normal situation where the volume of sales are going to be lower. Prices are going to slow down, but not that much. And it will become quite to a plateau for the next 2 years. So as you can see, this is quite positive. This is a quite positive outlook. However, there's a number of risks. As you know, there's a lot of turbulence around the economy. So there's two risks that we're really following to see if this positive outlook can be realized. The first one is the pandemic is not over. This is the number of cases in Canada. The big peak is Omicron just after Christmas. After we're just ending like a sixth wave of the virus. So the situation is quite good right now. So are we done? Well, the pandemic is not over, but the impact on the economy is pretty much done. And the reason for that is our level of vaccination. In Canada, 82% of all Canadians has been fully vaccinated. This is the highest level among all the developed economies. Only Japan is close at 80%. So we realize that the impact on the economy is much lower than used to be. Here we split the Canadian economy in two parts, accommodation and food services in green, the rest of the economy in blue. You can see that each time we have a wave of the virus, the level of employment has been fluctuating in accommodation and food services. But in the rest of the economy, beside the first wave, the pandemic has no longer an impact on the economy. So this is a risk. We are still following the pandemic because it's not over. But in Canada, the impact on the economy is pretty much over. We don't believe that the pandemic is going to slow down the economy. The second risk, and probably the most important one, is the fear of a recession. Are we going to have a recession? There's a lot of talk in the media about a recession that is coming pretty soon. Well, it's true that inflation is high. The inflation in Canada is 6.8%, much higher than what we used to see in Canada. So is it going to lead to recession? Well, Inflation is actually the result of the economy performing too well. People are buying or spending too much, and it's causing inflation. The war in Ukraine is also causing inflation. You can see it, for example, on this is the price of oil. Since the invasion of Ukraine, you can see that the price has been really increasing, and the price is going to stay elevated as the war is going on. Energy is not the only victim of the war. The price of wheat, for example, is really increasing, and wheat is a very important product because it goes into almost every food. So these prices, unfortunately, are going to stay elevated, and unfortunately, it's going to keep inflation in Canada at a high level. So we should expect that interest rates are going to keep increasing. Interest rate has increased twice since the beginning of this year, and we are expecting more increase. For example, at the beginning of July, the Bank of Canada is going to announce if they are going to increase it, and we expect another half a point increase in July. So there's two reasons why interest rates are increasing. And the first reason is because, you know, if you look at the graph, interest rate went down in 2020 because of the pandemic. So the Bank of Canada wanted to stimulate the economy. Now that the economy is back to normal, well, it's normal that interest rates are increasing. So that was expected. So as soon as the economy is back to normal, interest rate should go back to a more elevated or more normal level. And if you keep interest rate too low for too long, you create distortions. And that's exactly what happened in the housing market. If you own a house, I'm sure you're happy that the price of the housing market has been increasing significantly over the last 2 years. But this is not actually healthy for the economy. It's not healthy for the people who try to buy a house. So the second reason is, of course, is a lot of pressure on inflation. So by increasing interest rate, the Bank of Canada is trying to reduce inflation. So how far this is going to go? Well, this is a very good question. We believe that the interest rate is going to keep increasing this year and probably in 2023 to a prime rate between 2.5 and 3%. And the bank will hope that this will be enough to reduce inflation. So is this going to lead to recession? Well, it doesn't mean, you know, because you increase interest rate, there's a danger, there's a risk, but it doesn't mean that you are going into a recession. What the Bank of Canada is trying to do is to reduce inflation without killing the growth, so without having a recession. But of course, this is not an easy task to do. This is not clean cut. So we'll have to see what the Bank of Canada decide to do. But there's some worry about the level of mortgages having a variable rate. As you can see from this graph, the volume of mortgages with a variable rate in Canada has been increasing. It's very elevated now. So that means that each time the Bank of Canada is increasing interest rate, well, these people are paying more for their mortgages. The good news is we are paying less for mortgages than we used to in Canada. So our payment of interest rate represent 5.9% of our total budget. This is the average for Canada. Of course, some people pay way more than that, but the average for Canada is quite low, and it's lower. It's the lowest that we have seen over the last 20 years. So even if you increase interest rate, we believe that there's some room to go, because right now the portion of the Canadian budget to interest rate is quite low. And another good news is our level of default, mortgage default in Canada, is quite low as well. It's the lowest that we have seen. So people have a job, salaries are increasing. So despite the fact that interest rates are increasing, we don't believe this is going to lead to a recession. And a final note on this, we look back at the number of times that the different countries have increased interest rates since the 1960s. So in Canada, the Bank of Canada has increased interest rate over 200 basic points, so that's quite significant, 12 times, and that led to only two recessions. In the US, the Federal Reserve has increased interest rates since 1960 8 times, and that led to 4 recessions. If we take all the G7 countries, the most developed economies in the world, well, as you can see, the percentage is about 43%. So this, yes, interest rates are increasing. definitely, and they will keep increasing. Yes, it's increasing the risk of a recession, but doesn't mean that we're going to go to a recession. Like I said, the Bank of Canada is really trying to avoid a recession, but they want to make inflation going down. So we should expect that interest rates are going to increase. And so despite all this turbulence, we still are quite positive about the Canadian economy. We believe the growth this year is going to be 3.5%, which is very solid growth for Canada. The first quarter was very good at 3.1. So we still believe that the Canadian economy will continue to grow at a solid pace this year and also in 2023. I'm going to conclude this presentation on what to watch for if you are in the business world or if you own a business. There's two challenges that businesses are facing. The most important one right now is the supply chain problem. In Canada, 68% of businesses have experienced longer delivery time. 54% have difficulties to get the parts or the products or the raw materials they need. There's only 11% of Canadian business who said in our survey that they have no supply chain issue. So right now, this is probably the biggest issue that businesses are facing. The issue is bigger if you buy from outside the country. Supplies from outside the countries have more difficulties to delivery. And a big reason for that is coming from China. China has a lot of COVID cases. They have a zero COVID policy. They have a zero COVID policy. So it means that if you have a number of cases in the manufacturing plant, they will shut down the plant. Right now, there's 45 cities who are in a full or partial lockdown in China, which represent about 40% of the economy. So the economy, this is really causing a lot of distortion in the supply chain around the world. The good news is the situation is improving now. Shanghai was just opened last week. As you know, Shanghai is a big area and it's a very important area for export. So we believe that this situation is going to improve slowly over the next few months. It's going to take time before we go back to normal, but in the next 8 to 12 months, the situation should go back to normal. Another issue related to import is the cost of shipping. The cost of shipping has really increased during the pandemic. For example, a container coming from China to Canada used to cost about $2,500. It went up to $20,000 in the worst time of the pandemic. Now it's back to about $10,000. So the situation is improving. It's still very elevated and it should keep improving. So first, number one issue is the supply chain problems and the costs related to it. The good news is the worst is probably behind us. We believe that the situation will keep improving every month for the next until it's going back to normal. The second challenge is the labor shortage. 55% of Canadian businesses have difficulties to recruit people. And the reason is the fact that we have an aging population in Canada. 19% of Canadians are over 65 today, much higher percentage than what we used to see 20 years ago. So why is this a problem? Well, when you hit 65, well, basically you're retired. So a lot of baby boomers are retiring, they're leaving the job market, and that's causing this problem of shortage of labor. Unfortunately, this problem is not going to go away because of this graph. 21.6, let's say 22% of Canadian workers are over 55 today. So that means that in the next 10 years, these people are going to leave the workforce to retire. So imagine 22% of Canadian workers are going to retire in the next 10 years. It means that more than 4 million Canadians are going to retire. So unfortunately, the shortage of labor is not going to go away. It's going to be with us for the next decade. And the pandemic made things worse because during the pandemic, we didn't receive as much immigration as we used to in Canada. And as a result, our population growth has been really slowing down over the last 2 years. Well, this should really improve in 2022 now that the restrictions are over, but that really didn't help the shortage of labor for over the last 2 years. So what should business do? Well, I will invite you to visit our website at bdc.ca. We publish a very interesting report about what are the best strategies for business to face this issue of shortage of labor. But I can tell you that the best strategy is to invest in technology and automation. As this problem is not going to go away for the next decade, it's going to be difficult to hire people and it's going to be more costly. So the best strategy that the business can use is to invest in technology to reduce your need for workers. Technology doesn't replace people, but it could replace tasks that people are doing. So it could eliminate or reduce the number of workers that you need. So conclusion, there's a lot of turbulence in the economy. The shortage of labor, supply chain issue, interest rates are increasing, inflation is high, there's a war in Ukraine. But despite this turbulence, the economy in Canada is quite solid. And the demand for products and services, the demand for business is quite solid. The biggest challenge is a supply chain problem, which should improve over the next few months, and the shortage of labor, which unfortunately, people have to be creative, have to find different solutions because unfortunately it's going to stay with us. But we are not expecting a recession. Yes, the level of risk is high, but we believe that the economy is going to have a solid growth in 2022 and also in 2023. So let me, we're going to stop here and we'll have time for questions.
Thank you, Pierre, for that very insightful outlook and for breaking down the complexities of navigating these market dynamics. So let's jump a bit more into some of those burning questions. I know you talked a lot about the interest rate hikes, but can we maybe discuss the correlation with interest rate hikes and housing? So just last week, the Bank of Canada announced an interest rate hike of 0.5%, and many economists are predicting another 50 to 75 basis point increase in early as July. So as some analysts predict, this may cause a correction in our housing market of about 15 to 20%. So could this lead to a potential cooling off of the real estate market and maybe even improve housing affordability? In your presentation, you mentioned that prices increased over 44% since the start of the pandemic. So it, you know, as you said, it probably won't return to those levels, but what would your advice to newcomers and first-time home buyers, or even those just looking to invest in real estate, be, you know, people looking to invest as a form of passive income? So is there any advice we could leave them with?
Well, I agree with your statement that interest rates will keep increasing. We believe the prime rate is probably going to be 2.5 or 3% in the next 2 years. So we believe that the housing market is going to cool down. We don't believe that prices is going to decline as much as some economists would say, 20%. And the reason for that is there's a lot of immigration coming to Canada and there's a shortage of houses in Canada. So the fact that the economy is still performing well, salaries are increasing, the job market is good, immigration will support the growth of the market. So we believe that, yes, the market is going to be much more stable. We're not going to see price increase in the next 2 years. Probably price will decline in some markets, for example, in Toronto, where price went up very, very quickly. But we don't see that in Vancouver, for example. So even in Toronto, where the price is slowly declining, it should maybe would decline by 10%, but we don't believe it's going to be, like you said, going back to the pre-crisis level. So the advice is I would wait before making an acquisition of a house right now. I would wait to see what would be the full impact of interest rate. We should know by the end of this year, because I think the plan of the bank is to increase interest rate rapidly and wait, see the impact on the economy. So by the end of this year, we should have a better idea of where the housing market is going to land. And having said that, I believe that in the future, like if we take a 5-year horizon, the housing market will be still a very good investment. We are increasing the level of immigration in Canada because of our shortage of labor. So the demand for housing will remain strong in the next 5 years.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you. Oh, I can see you now.
Okay, so I mean that was great. You know, maybe just talking more about, you know, inflation and interest rate hikes. So the consumer price index is three times that of the Bank of Canada's target of 2%. And as you said, and I think we're all anticipating that the Bank of Canada will continue raising interest rates into the second half of the year and well into 2023 in an attempt to combat the hyperinflationary environment that we are currently in. What other measures or levers have policymakers resorted to in the past? And do you think other forms of intervention need to be deployed simultaneously to bring inflation into check? And what will this mean to those individuals that are highly leveraged or still servicing personal debt?
Well, the situation is not easy because this time, part of the inflation is coming from outside Canada. So, and we don't have control on that. So for example, the war in Ukraine is increasing commodity prices, which is increasing the price of gasoline that we buy every day, the price of food that we buy every day. So it's hard for the Bank of Canada to have an impact on inflation. So by increasing interest rate, they are going to slow down the housing market, for example. So the price of some commodities like lumber is going to slow down. And it should slow down consumption in Canada, which is part of inflation, but they won't have an impact on the war in Ukraine, and they won't have an impact on the supply chain problem. So that's the reason why we believe that despite the action from the bank, inflation will remain elevated longer than what they would like to. So hopefully they will not keep increasing interest rate, because if they do, we can create a recession. So that's why the situation is quite difficult. Other measure, they already stop helping, like what we call quantitative easing. So they have stopped that. So this is a measure that the bank was able to do. But that's basically the two tools they have. So they have, you know, done one, they are increasing interest rate. There's not much else they can do. What other governments can do is to slow down spending, because by spending more, you stimulate inflation. So for example, some provincial governments have compensated people by giving them money or tax break because the gasoline price is increasing. Well, it sounds like a good idea, but if you give people more money, they are going to spend it and you create more pressure on prices. So another action is all governments should slow down their spending to reduce the pressure on inflation.
This is actually perfect, and it brings me to my next question regarding stagflation. So the World Bank issued a warning earlier this week of global stagflation. So for viewers at home who are not familiar with this term, it's a toxic mix of high inflation and sluggish growth, which was last seen in the 70s. The World Bank also forecasts that the global economy will grow by 2.9%, which is about half of what it did in 2021. Also, just yesterday, the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development, the OECD, downgraded its forecast for global GDP by about 1.5% to 3% for 2022. Will we feel the impact of this kind of closer to home? And can the Bank of Canada really slow down inflation and avoid the recession completely? And what can business owners and entrepreneurs do to brace themselves and maybe prepare for the worst?
A lot of good questions here. We're not too afraid of stagflation in Canada because growth is quite solid right now. And the disturbance that we see, for example, in Europe, it's slowing down the European economy, but it's actually helping Canada, because we produce a lot of commodities that Russia and Ukraine is producing. So for example, the fact that the oil price is increasing, which is slowing down the world economy, but it's actually helping the Canadian economy because we produce a lot of oil. 20% of everything we export is related to oil. Same thing for agriculture products like wheat. We produce a lot of wheat. We produce a lot of metals like aluminum and nickel and steel that is helping the Canadian economy. So stagflation is not big concern right now for Canada. We are kind of lucky. We have a very diversified economy, including a lot of natural resources. So right now we're benefiting from this turbulence in Europe. Inflation, like I said, inflation, there's three reasons why we have inflation. The strong demand from Canadians, the war in Ukraine, and the supply chain disruptions. So when you increase interest rate, you will have an impact on the first one, on consumption. The war in Ukraine, Canada has no impact on that. So unfortunately, the inflation that is coming from that event, there's not much we can do. The supply chain, well, it's improving now, and it should improve. So that should really reduce the pressure on price on that. So the hope is that the action in terms of interest rates should slow down inflation, and that should be enough. But there's a risk. The risk is you increase interest rate too much, and that's really that lead to a recession. We don't believe that is going to happen, but there's definitely more risk today than 6 months ago.
Great. But do you see kind of this leveling off, or do we see any price stability, or do you think the situation would still remain dire due to the worsening geopolitical uncertainty, especially with the situation surrounding the Russia-Ukraine war and its implications on the global food supply?
I think it's, for example, food price would keep increasing just because, this is the summer. Ukraine should produce a lot of wheat and soybeans and other products, and they are not able to do so. So unfortunately, the price of food is going to stay elevated. Same thing for the price of oil and gas, the price of gasoline. So unfortunately, inflation is not going to go down as rapidly as normal. When you increase interest rate, normally inflation is going down. But this time around, because we don't control everything, it's going to take longer time.
So let's talk a little bit about the labor crisis. So as previously discussed, Canadian inflation hit a new 31-year high in April as prices surged for commodities and everyday items. The consumer price index rose to 6.8% year over year. However, the average hourly wage only rose 3.3% on an annual basis, which means that the average worker is seeing their purchasing power decline. So how is this kind of magnifying the situation or impacting businesses who are already experiencing difficulties hiring qualified workers and facing labor shortages? What are policymakers doing to improve the labor situation? Have we seen an increase in immigration or expansion of the migrant worker programs? How else do we plan to combat this labor crisis? And what could this mean for the job market?
I think businesses should expect that salaries would keep increasing. And there's two reasons you mentioned. Inflation is high, so there's pressure to increase in salaries because of that. But probably the most important reason is because of the aging population we have. So we don't have a lot of baby boomers are leaving the workplace. So that's the reason why we have this shortage of labor. And when you have a shortage of labor, salaries are increasing. So for business people, they should expect salaries to keep increasing for the next few years. And the best way to protect themselves against that is to reduce their need for workers in investing in automation, investing in technology. There's a long way, we can really improve the adoption of technology in Canada. When we compare Canada with the US or other developed economies, we're far from being champion. So the cost of labor was low in Canada compared to other developed economies, compared to France, Germany, UK. We were low. Now this is going to be a new normal. Our costs are going to increase, and they were going to stay elevated. So businesses will have to change the way they are doing business, using more technology, less people, because people are going to be difficult to find and they're going to be more expensive. Salaries are going to keep increasing even after the inflation is back to normal.
Okay, perfect. So just talking about, you know, entrepreneurs. So if the last 2 years have taught us anything, it's resilience. Have certain sectors and businesses had to change and adapt new operating models and transform their platforms as a result? What could young budding entrepreneurs or emerging businesses take note of in terms of industry best practices and any lessons learned from those having lived and thrived through some of the toughest times and uncertainties brought on by the global pandemic that is hopefully now behind us?
I think the first lesson is businesses have been very resilient. They have been very, very good to innovate, to create a new business model, to change very quickly because the situation was very difficult, especially at the beginning of the pandemic. Our business environment have changed. Businesses who have been investing in technology over the last 2 years have been performing better. As you know, a lot of consumers decided to buy online. The online business in Canada tripled compared to the beginning of the pandemic. So one thing that we have learned, one new business environment is the fact that consumers are buying much more online than before. Secondly, a lot of people are working from home. And our research is showing that consumers or people want to continue to work from home at least a few days a week. So this is also changing our business model. We're going to see, you know, it's the case right now, about 20% of Canadians are working from home. And we don't believe we're going to go back to the pre-crisis level. We have kind of a hybrid model where you work 1 or 2 days a week from the office and the rest of the week you work from home. So this is quite different than in the past. And something we have learned is you have to make sure that your business is very efficient. When the pandemic hit, nobody could have predicted that. So it happened very, very quickly. So business who performed or was less damaged, there were businesses who were very efficient. So they reduced their costs. Also, they were a lot of technology integration. So they were able to move to a different way of doing things very quickly. So something we have learned, investing in technology, reducing your costs, be a very efficient business is the best way to be resilient when something happens in the economy.
Okay, wonderful. So let's talk a little bit about the slower growth in 2022. So opening up the economy has been welcome news to all, especially those businesses most impacted by the lockdowns, such as those in food services and hospitality industry. However, the rising fuel prices and cost of air travel has somewhat deterred the rate in the uptick of tourism that we'd hoped for. Are businesses seeing an impact, and how has this hampered maybe the preparations based on expectations coming into 2022?
Well, the situation, we are in a kind of different situation where the demand is strong, but the big issue is the supply. So costs for business, the cost of everything is increasing. They have supply chain problems and they have difficulties to find people. So the demand for most businesses, the demand is very strong. The issue is making sure that they are able to meet the demand. And a lot of business, their profit are squeezed just because, yes, the demand is strong, but the cost of everything, including salaries, has been increasing. So as we move away from the pandemic, some of these things are going to improve. For example, the supply chain distortions should go away. Inflation should slow down, so the cost of input should improve, really. The only thing is the shortage of labor is going to stay with us. So we believe that we're going into a new normal where the cost structure for Canadian businesses are going to be higher than in the past. So it means that businesses will have to manage differently. We'll have to take into account that we're not going to go back to the level of price we had before the pandemic. So they will have to make different decisions, maybe changing their business model in some cases, because we are going to stay after this pandemic with a higher cost structure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, talking more about the cost structure. So especially as you already mentioned, businesses which depend on imports. So they've seen a huge, you know, they're seeing their cost skyrocket, you know, that coupled with China's zero COVID policy, which has caused these unprecedented supply chain challenges. But with the increase in input costs and consumers now getting used to paying higher prices everywhere, so we pay higher at the pumps and even in grocery stores, are we seeing that maybe businesses are able to push more costs to end consumers and maybe, you know, able to maintain their profit margins at all?
It really depends on the sector. In some sectors, businesses are able to put the price, increase the price of their products. In our research, about 60% of businesses were able to increase the cost of their products or services. But in some businesses, it's not possible, especially for businesses who are not selling directly to consumer. So for if you sell to another business and your cost is increasing, often you're not able to increase your price because you're selling to a very large organization. So you're squeezed in terms of your profit. So it really depends of the sector of the economy. In some cases, they are able to pass the inflation of, to the consumer. In some cases, they are not.
Right. I know you talked about automation already. So maybe we want to spend a little bit of time there. So, you know, we're saying businesses that are focused on the future and on innovation always tend to prosper. But have you, you know, you pulled a SMEs in your report. Have you started seeing, you know, and them invest more in automation to improve efficiencies and labor shortages? So kind of, you know, primarily thinking of those facing the highest demand, such as in manufacturing sector, where technology, automation, and even AI can complement or even replace the need for human intervention, especially, you know, in those repetitive tasks. So have you kind of seen that uptick in investment into innovations as of already?
We see two things. The first one is an increase. More and more businesses are investing in technology. Last year, 90% of small and mid-sized firms in Canada have invested in technology. This is the highest percentage we've ever seen before. So this is a good news. We also see, we just released a report and we compare the performance of 1,500 companies and we made a correlation with their level of investment in technology. And what we find is businesses who are investing more in technology, they perform better in terms of revenue growth, profit growth as well. So this is in the new context, post-pandemic, we believe this is the future of Canadian businesses, is to invest in technology because, like I said, the cost of hiring people is really increasing. And when we talk about technology and automation, we used to talk mostly about manufacturing, but technology has really changed, really evolved, and you can use automation in every sector of the economy now, in mm-hmm. services as well. Even accounting firm, they're using, you know, artificial intelligence to do part of their job. And we see that, give you two examples, which I find fascinating because we often think that it's only large businesses. But in our report, we talked about one of our clients. It's a drugstore. The two owners were husband and wife. They were both pharmacists. They couldn't find a technician during the pandemic. Mm-hmm. So they bought this pill sorting machine. So you basically enter 200 different kind of pills and this machine is making prescriptions by itself. And like the owner said, the good news about it is they don't make mistakes. And when you prepare prescriptions, obviously you don't want to make mistakes. So this is a good example. Small business, only two owners, they replace technicians by technology. So you don't need to be a large business. You don't need to be in manufacturing. You could be in the service sector. Another good example I thought was this company that is cleaning pools. And they usually hire students in the summer to do that. This year, they have a very hard time to find students. So they bought robots and they serve their clients with a robot that cleaned the pool. So they still have somebody going to check the water, if the water is okay. But instead of spending an hour, the person spends 15 minutes. So technology can help. And this is, you know, in the context of shortage of labor, the aging population in Canada, this is our way out. This is our way of success.
Okay, wonderful. And so finally, in closing, you know, what is your economic outlook and advice for newcomers to Canada? Do you anticipate many challenges for new immigrants? Or do you foresee some inherent opportunities in certain sectors that new immigrants with relevant skill sets can capitalize on?
Yeah. Well, the good news is going to be plenty of jobs. Right now, there's about 800,000 vacant jobs in the country. There's more jobs than people. So the good news for people who are coming to Canada is there's a lot of opportunities, and actually a lot of business need them. In terms of the sector that is growing the fastest is technology. This sector has been growing they had the best growth before the pandemic, and they still have the best growth. And with the level of investment in technology, we believe that this sector will continue to really have the highest growth in the country. So many sectors are doing well, but technology is doing even better.
Okay, great. Well, thanks for addressing those burning questions. The session has been extremely informative. I feel there was something for everyone. And just to recap some of the key takeaways. So for entrepreneurs looking to start a new business or expand their existing operations, you know, you mentioned automation and investment in automation. You know, they can also leverage the BDC for free tools and advice, as well as financing, advisory services, and capital. For those businesses affected by the labor shortages brought on by the pandemic, as well as the aging workforce and the pandemic's halt on immigration in the past 2 years, Pierre, you mentioned several measures such as, you know, investing in technology and automation, using a formal hiring process, offering a total compensation package, and expanding the hiring pool. You know, the word to newcomers into our great country that might be wondering what areas and fields to expand their expertise in. As you said, we have a ton of vacancies. We are seeing a lot of opportunities, especially in the hospitality and service industries, where they still have not been able to staff at pre-pandemic levels. You know, there was something first-time home buyers out there, maybe wondering if it's prudent to delay purchases and just wait as the markets start to cool with rising interest rates and potentially even bottom out maybe in the second half of this year. And finally, to our veterans, investors, looking to protect their investments and continue to build generation wealth. The good news is that the Canadian economy is looking strong and GDP growth is anticipated this year and in 2023. Unemployment is at an all-time low and the consumption of goods have rebounded due to savings accumulated during the pandemic and pent-up demand to the extent that consumer demand has outpaced supply. However, the worsening situation in Ukraine has pushed up oil and agriculture prices. Inflation is at a 31-year high. And as a result, the Bank of Canada will continue to implement quantitative tightening measures, such as interest rate hikes, well into next year, until we near the government's target inflation of about 2.5% to 3%. So I just wanted to leave everyone with some references. So in closing, for our viewers at home, there has been a lot of great information shared today, and there is much to consider. You can visit the II Canada website for continuous and timely economic updates at www.iicanada.org/economic-financial-planning. You will also find the recording of today's discussion for your reference there. For any further information or support, you can contact the access line at 1-888-536-3599 or visit www.iicanada.org/access. Also, we would encourage participants to join igniteexchange.net. It's Alliances Canada's online digital community platform where you can network with members across the country, join an alliance, review discussions and job boards, and participate in ongoing events. I would like to thank you all for joining us, and thank you again, Pierre, for sharing your insight and spending your time with the Canadian Ismaili Muslim community. Thank you all, and enjoy the rest of your evening.